I mean, he doesn't want to run, he's doing it.
My wife.
It's a strain.
It's a.
They haven't started?
Yes.
It's from. My distinguished list.
Something. Several times.
Yes.
It's a. Doesn't.
Recycle. You need to see the chest up.
No, I can check.
Okay, we'll get it at the end.
Okay, we will get started with the meeting. We'll start with a roll call by the town clerk.
Chairman McKinney?
Here.
Counselor Backer?
Present.
Counselor Dill?
Here.
Counselor Lennon?
Present.
Counselor Lynch?
Present.
Counselor Rowe?
Here.
Counselor Swift Kayata?
Here.
Manager McGovern?
Yep.
Let's stand for the Pledge of Allegiance.
Pledge of Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Minutes of meeting number 4-2007, held March 5th, 2007. Does anybody have any corrections? Ann?
For the March 5th meeting, I have a few. On item number 42, and this, I'm not sure if it's correction or I just can't remember. It said Counselor Rowe had spoken about the benches at Holman Field and said that an offer from his company to lay the concrete brick still stands. I thought it was to donate.
Just to provide the concrete blocks.
So perhaps to provide would be a better wording. And then on item number 43, at the very top of the next page, it said motion S. Kayata. It should be A. Swift Kayata. And item number 45, never mind, I'm sorry, that one was no problem. Item number 53.
Restraint.
The last line of it, the line right before item number 54, it says, ordered that the Cape Elizabeth Town Council refer items numbered 52 to 61 to the Town Council Finance Committee. It should be 53 through 61, I believe. Because item number 52 is a Fort Williams thing.
The clerk submitted an agenda.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Revised,
that was
revised agenda. That was corrected.
I'm sorry. I didn't catch that.
Okay. Do I hear a motion to accept the minutes as amended?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor? Okay. Reports and correspondence. Does anybody have any reports and correspondence? Ann?
I just wanted to let the council and the citizens know that I attended the National League of Cities meeting as a representative of Cape Elizabeth and also as a representative of the Maine Municipal Association in Washington, D.C. from March 11th to 14th. We met with all four of our congressional delegation, our two representatives and our two senators, had very productive meetings with them, talking about issues that were important to municipalities all over the state and in particular important to Cape Elizabeth. I just wanted to let you know if anybody has any questions about what we went over. I won't go on at length about it, but we saw interesting speakers, a number of people who are running for president. That was very interesting, and as I said, of more particular interest to us were our meetings with the senators and the representatives and their staffs.
Jim, do you have anything?
No.
Anybody else? I have one item, and it is the There was a newspaper article left in my mailbox from the town recycling committee, and I just wanted to make a comment that the recycling committee we currently have in Cape Elizabeth is doing an absolutely outstanding job keeping the council informed and the citizenry informed, more importantly, about recycling efforts and what can be done to improve them. Anybody, anything else? Okay. Town managers' report.
Thank you, Paul. There's five bullets that I mentioned on the prior agenda that I wish to speak about, and I want to add an additional bullet. I'll do the bullets first, other than Matt, and then Matt will be doing as part of my report, an update on the potential for revaluation. First of all, I want to mention that the 2006 town report's now available for anyone who wishes to peruse it. They're up on the tax counter, if anyone would like to pick one up. The Spurwink Avenue paving, as well as the traffic light out here at this intersection, is probably delayed as a result of MDOT funding issues. The legislature approved a bond issue to go on the ballot on June 12th to help deal with some of those issues, but in the meantime, there'll be no bidding allowed until after June 30th, and this proposal here was originally, back of me, I'm pointing to the traffic signal, was originally due to go out to bid in May. The Spurwink Avenue paving's in the same boat, unfortunately, and when you deal with state agencies beyond your control, there tend to be delays. So it'll be on the ballot June 12th to approve or not approve a state bond issue, and some Cape Elizabeth projects will be, depending on the outcome of that bond issue, it would appear. Any questions on that?
Michael, if presuming that the bond issue is approved in June, will there be enough time with the bidding process and everything to start work on either one of those projects during this construction year?
That's a good question.
Thank you.
And there's a couple of issues that come into it. One is the longer you wait, the more expensive bids tend to be. Another point is that PACS, the Regional Transportation Planning Agency, has been asked to prioritize now what things they actually want to go out to bid in 2007. And the early list that we're seeing from the PAC staff of their recommendations do not include either of those projects, which means they wouldn't go out to bid until 2008.
If I could follow up. If it isn't a priority for PACS, does that mean it would eventually go out in 2008 to bid, or does it mean it could fall off the list completely?
I'm confident that both projects are going to stay on the list. However, I can't predict MDOT's timetables.
Thank you.
Continue on?
Okay.
Just wanted to make everyone aware that the cable TV franchise is expiring early in 2008, which means that it's time to begin to consider the issues that we might want to consider as part of the renewal of the franchise. We've had a couple of successive franchises from 1977 on with Time Warner Cable, and before that with ATC, American, whatever they called it. And before that it was with Public Cable Company, all really the same company as it evolved. They more or less have the market locked up in Maine now, except the Dish Network and, you know, those types of things. When you look at their list of the communities they now serve, it's, you know, well over 100 communities in Maine. We're also much handicapped by the fact that the federal government is very explicit these days through the FCC and has just had rulings that, you know, it would appear to be adverse to really any ability to negotiate. You know, there are some provisions we can talk about with them, but, you know, as one small community, as the way this industry has evolved out of hundreds, perhaps thousands around the country, we don't have a whole lot of flexibility on some of the issues. But if there are particular cable issues that any citizen has that they wish us to to raise with Time Warner, this is a good chance to do it. And there's really no ability to go out to another vendor. As those of you that follow the cable industry would, are aware that, you know, short of us installing our own cable system, which is problematic because we don't have the negotiating strength to deal with Time Warner, who also owns half the TV stations, it's a difficult uphill slog. Any questions on that?
I had a question, Mike. Do the contracts of each town and municipality expire and renew at different times?
You are correct.
Thank you.
I had given the council some materials about 18 acres behind Sherwood Forest. It's an issue that some of the residents that have raised, they'd like to see that preserved. The town has a partial ownership interest. Beyond that, as you saw with the materials, you know, that some of the ownership interests are like 1/32nd of the property. So anyway, Tom Leahy, our town attorney, is working on that. In fact, I just received copies of letters today that he sent to the principal owners, indicating if they had interests, as in particularly one, as she did a few years ago, and perhaps donating her interests for conservation purposes. So anyway, now that, you know, we've done some of the title work on that, we're proceeding with determining the interests of some of the lead parties in donating their interests. I think what the hope is that we would, you know, obtain a majority interest and then approach the council perhaps about some options as to quieting the title with the balance of the interest. And you know, and that could, there's a number of ways to do that, which, you know, once we own a majority, might be worthwhile discussing at that point for conservation purposes. Any questions on that? Before I ask Matt, the one other bullet I mentioned is I did want to thank everyone for their assistance with the storm this past week, particularly the dispatchers, where a lot of the calls come in, the Public Works Department, the Police Department, the Fire Department, as well as the citizens of the town and CMP and the other utilities, for the most part, getting us all back up in pretty good shape, pretty quick. When one looks out there and see all the branches down, it was quite an extensive storm, and you know, did quite a bit of damage in Cape Elizabeth, and as Bob can attest to, Bob Malley, it's going to take a while to clean up. Public Works began actually on Friday, continued today, working with a contractor of cleaning up brush at the side of the roadways. A lot of citizens are putting it out at the side of the roadways. We are picking that up. We're also waiving all of the brush fees at the transfer station, the Cape Elizabeth Recycling Center, through the end of April. Anyone has questions about the pickup, there's a brief article on the website about it, as well as they could give Public Works a call. The other thing I do want to mention is that we had a tremendous challenge on Thursday morning with the calls to the Cape Elizabeth Dispatch Center. We had well over 100 calls, if not a couple hundred calls, of folks asking when their power is coming back on. We don't have a direct pipeline to CMP. You know, I read up to 117,000 households out. One of the challenges we're finding is people no longer own transistor radios. And you know, they get used to the internet for looking at the no school announcements or turning on the television, and so instead they're waking up if their alarm clocks go off, but they're waking up, and well, maybe they don't need alarm clocks, and they're calling the dispatcher to find out if the school, when my power is coming on, and that's not really an appropriate use for the dispatch, particularly when, you know, the fire department that day, according to what Phil McGoldrick told the fire chief, told the council at the finance committee the other night, there were 50 calls that day alone for the fire department that were calls of a serious nature in terms of wires arcing and rescue calls and the rest of it. So it's, you know, the dispatch number is not the number to call for routine informational questions. You know, the town hall was open that entire day, our phones were running. You know, we're happy to answer those calls, and the library was open. They'd be happy to answer those calls, and you know, while you know, we may not always be on because we don't have a generator that really works that well. You know, it's still, it's, you know, folks need to be patient and make a little investment of self-reliance on transistor radios or battery-powered radios so that, you know, they can find out directly as we do. You know, we were finding out news just like everyone else from, you know, listening to the radio and actually look, checking the internet. For those that have web access, the CMP website is really good, and while someone may not have direct access to it if their phones are working, they can be calling someone in another community who does have internet access to find out, you know, updates as opposed to calling the dispatcher. So I've gone on at length about that, but the dispatchers, if you were there, it's a little bit scary because they don't have time to answer the emergency calls when they're so tied up with informational calls. Any questions on any of that?
Can I make a suggestion?
Yes.
I think a telephone answering machine, one in the school and one in the town hall that no person had to be at, that would simply give you the basic information. The school one is critical. I have to admit, I called the non-emergency police because I woke up at my normal time and I had no access to any information, and my kid had 20 minutes to get to school or not. So it's the only person in the town who has any information. So if you just had a recording that said there's no school today and ditto with anything like a power outage or emergency, one phone number that everyone would know. It could be like town business here, school business, with a recording. That would go a long way, and it would be just an answering machine.
We do have a phone number, 767 CAPE, that does provide that information.
Oh.
But it's, but again, if it's not known, we need to make sure it's known. But that, along with transistor radios, and, you know, I always used to listen to WGAN in the morning. As a kid growing up in Portland, and always used to have to wait to hear the peas, praying all the way till we get to that point. So anyway, anyone's cooperation on that would help. Ann has some question.
Ann.
I think Councilor Lennon has a good point in that I think there are very, well, I don't know, I'm surmising there aren't that many people who remember that there is the 767 CAPE number. And perhaps it would be worth our while publicizing it on the website and in the Courier, prominently putting it up there so that more people would realize.
We're concerned enough about it that the discussion we had this morning at the department head meeting is, in addition to all those things you've mentioned, is the plan is to actually put it in the tax bills when we send a townwide mailing as a highlight in the next tax bills of encouraging folks to be prepared for emergencies. Better than, I think we all take it for granted that it's not going to happen to us. And, you know, I'm as guilty as anyone else. So it's, you know, I don't have a generator. I don't do all those things. So, you know, looking in the mirror, it's all these things apply to me as well. So I don't mean to be critical of anyone. I think it's just we tend to be spoiled and think that everything's going to be ready when we hope it to be.
Maybe we can also ask the school department to communicate at the beginning of school when they send all those packages home and in the school directory that this number is available as well.
Mm-hmm. But the other challenge with that is even that line
has to be
it's
jammed at a time.
Yeah, that gets jammed as well. I think there's two lines that are available under the 76 CAPE number. And if those get jammed up, then so. But that's why I suggest all these different alternatives. And I didn't mean to belabor that point. The point I really wanted to do was to thank all the folks who helped get us out of that mess. So with that, Matt Sturgis is prepared to give you an update on revaluation.
Wonderful. Matt.
I apologize for the length of the report tonight, but not at all. Some things to talk about.
Good.
Well, thank you very much. Thanks, Michael, Mr. Chairman, members of the council. Glad to see you again tonight after getting together last Thursday night at the budget hearing. I'll try to make this fairly brief because there's not a lot of data to bring forward at this point, just kind of be more informative and kind of let you know what our current assessment status is. When it comes down to it, there are really four questions that one thinks about when planning an assessment update. First of all, it's what does an assessment update really mean? Revaluation is a fairly intimidating term. And it puts the fear into many property taxpayers, I being one of them. So try to stay with update, because that's really what we're trying to do, is update the current values. Why do we do assessment updates? When will this take place? And who will do the work? Well, an assessment update ultimately means it's an update of values from the current assessment, which is based on 2003 values, to 2008 values for next year. Not this current tax bill coming up in August, but a year from this coming August. And how are we going to update these values? It's fairly technical, but it's also very mechanical. You change or update the current construction cost tables. The current tables that we're using now are based on 2003 costs. Things have changed. Progress goes forward. Materials get more expensive. Materials get less expensive. But nevertheless, the schedules need to be updated. They're also based on the pricing of materials and labor and other costs that took place at that time that have since been outdated. Many of those numbers are updated using local suppliers, cost manuals that are nationally produced, as well as discussions and with local contractors, as well as review of building permit information that we receive in the office to make sure that we're consistent with the pricing. Also need to, and this is where the heavy lifting of the project comes forward, and it's in updating land tables and the pricing of land. It's not as easily defined, and it's not as easily identified because of locational differences, neighborhood differences, other differences that exist that make pricing in one section of town more expensive than another pricing in another section of town, which may be less expensive. Well, we get those sales by get that information by looking at vacant land sales and extracting them from improved sales. Like a house sells, you know, it costs so much to build a house, so you subtract the price of the house, and this really simplifies it, but you simply subtract the price of the house from the sale price. The remaining value is attributable to the land somewhat. Now, this update versus 2003's revaluation or update we did then is a bit different. We won't be going to all 4,350 parcels in the town of Cape Elizabeth and reviewing them, measuring the properties, or going to each one and physically inspecting them. Quite frankly, our data is very, very good and very reliable. We spent a heck of a lot of money 4 years ago to do the last revaluation, and it was money well spent. And there's no reason to reinvent the wheel and spend all that money again to find out what we already know. Also, I actively update the town records. So if there's been a new addition, an alteration, or demolition, we've gone out, tracked that, and corrected the record accordingly. Now, why do we perform these updates? There are two real strong reasons to do this: equity and just value. Those are the two basic tenets of property taxation in the state of Maine. Equity means ultimately that comparable properties are similarly assessed. Sounds pretty basic. It's a lot more difficult than it is. It doesn't mean that a house in one section of town is going to be the same assessment as another section of town, but if you had those two houses sitting next to each other, they pretty much should expect to be assessed at about the same value if all things being considered equal. It also is to bring equity in the tax burden, to basically try to ensure that someone's not paying more than their fair share, or someone's not paying less than their fair share. Ultimately, this is the way that we can right the ship, if you will. If it's leaning to port, we get it more to starboard, if you will. This kind of gives us the opportunity to do that. The law also requires that we treat properties equitably, and we try our darndest to do it, and also keeps us out of the appeals process pretty much, which I try to keep us away from as best as I can through my efforts. The other concern, is, as I said, is just value. And just value is, if you want to really come up with a term that most people know, it's market value. They have a long description of it in property tax law, but it's ultimately comparable to market value. And the way to measure that just value, or to understand what your current relationship is to just value is through assessment ratio studies. Sounds pretty technical, but it's really just dividing the assessed value by the sale price. It's that relationship. So it gives us an understanding of what the level of assessment is of individual properties. And then taking that as a whole through a block of sales, say the 300 that took place in this past year, we then can understand what that snapshot of that group of properties that sold in the past year indicates the assessment level is in the community. The reason why we do that is so we can understand understand when we report to the state that we're in compliance of what state requirements are. And the state requires that we maintain a minimum of 70% assessment ratio, not to exceed 110%. The assessment ratio for Cape Elizabeth going forward into 2008, based on my studies through, well, the state uses July 1 to June 30th, so through January, we're at 66% assessed value based on the current sales to date. In 2003, when we completed the assessment the last time we did a reval, we were at 100% of full market value. So 34% in 5 years, more or less, is what we're looking at. Not bad in comparison to other towns. Compared to the county, we're probably doing pretty bad. But overall, our assessment ratio is comparable to other towns, is what they've done over the trends in the past 4 years. Now, when will this happen? I anticipate this project to start with your permission, of course, in early summer of 2007. So probably about the time I get done pricing out everything that happened in this last year and put the books to bed for the past year and get ready for the next year, we'll have to get started on doing the new assessment. During that project, I'll review approximately 400 sales that took place over the study period to identify. It's not a question of going to them, walking around, and investigating them, but more or less going there, trying to figure out, you know, does this look consistent with what my data has shown me? If it doesn't, try to figure out why. I do that anyhow, but this will be a little bit more of an in-depth analysis that we have to perform. We do it monthly, so I kind of keep a track as to where the town actually sits. But this will be more along the lines specifically tailored to this project. I'm looking at updating the cost and the land pricing by early fall, beginning that process. Basically, it's a ton of spreadsheet work, a lot of analysis, trying to figure out what subtleties exist within the market, within neighborhoods, and sometimes in some parts of town, it gets to that point where certain streets within certain neighborhoods sell for more. It makes sense when you look at it, and obviously the buyers kind of tell you where the value is. And then I'm looking at testing the model by the fall and trying to figure out, okay, if change A happens, how does that sit as far as treating these properties in relationship to other properties? With the goal being full market value and a high level of equity among the assessments. So one neighborhood, for instance, isn't paying a greater portion than another neighborhood, and one street isn't paying that greater than another portion of town. And then after all that testing is done and retesting and hopefully coming forward with some strong results, which I don't really have any fear that they're going to come out with, a notification of new values will take place by February of 2008. So we'll have, last time it was shortly after the start of April, and it was through June that I was doing hearings. So this way I'll have a lot of that work completed. A lot of folks will understand what their values will be, finalized values well in hand and in time for commitment in the following August for when tax bills go out. I think, at this point, to allay a lot of fears, it's also important to note that the equity level or the assessment level in town is fairly evenly distributed. Most neighborhoods have receded from market value in a fairly uniform fashion. So there are a couple of pockets or some areas of town that are further away from market value than others. So those sections will probably see their taxes increase in comparison to other parts of town. You know, the old adage they say is one third will go up, one third will go down, one third of the property's taxes will stay the same. I don't like blanket statements that much. I think, you know, it all depends upon what takes place with the mill rate, so you really can't use it as a rule of thumb, but I think, you know, overall, the change will be fairly even, especially in comparison to 4 years ago, when there was such a significant change. It had been 9 years since the last revaluation. Some properties were assessed at 30% of market value, others were assessed at 70%. So some folks really took a penalization as a result of the market changes, and were really caught off guard. Even though through our best efforts of letting people know what was going to take place, it still was a traumatic experience, to say the least. Finally, who will perform this work? The project will be performed in-house. So you're looking at the guy, basically, who's going to be doing the work. It's my second time around, so I'm a lot more comfortable about it this time after, you know, I've been here 6 years now, and at that time I was here for two, so I'm a lot more comfortable and feel I have a lot more local experience now than I did even then. The estimated cost will be approximately $25,000, and it's in this year's CIP request. And you know, to be quite frank, it's considerably less expensive than if we outsourced it to a private firm. And we would have to have them come in, do a lot of changes, and learn our tables, make a lot more money off it than, you know, they have profit that we don't have to worry about. I'm trying to perform the service the best that I can for the least amount of money, so we can say, you know, there's no reason that they need to have a tax increase to finance a revaluation. So ultimately, that's why we're trying to do it as cost-effective as possible. And because of the software upgrades and changes that we did at the end of the last revaluation, or performing the last update, they allow us to update the schedules based on the analysis that we need to perform now, so we can do a lot of that work, I guess you could call it, automatically, and make changes on a much greater scale and a much more efficient manner, than we did before. So, sorry, it takes a while to explain all this, but I tried to make it as as overview as I could at this point in time. I look forward to giving you updates in the future, probably through memos, as we get further along in the process, as I did last time, and also, you know, prior to revealing the, you know, the man behind the mirror, so to speak, and the numbers of the revaluation, bringing forward another presentation as I did at the conclusion of the process. So. But I thank you for your time, and if you have any questions, I'm more than happy to answer them. Or if you have questions that come up later, just holler at me. I'm happy to answer them too at another time.
Any questions? David?
Matt, can you explain the ratio of 66%, which is where you think we stand today? That's a ratio of your 2005 assessed value?
It's actually, it's the relationship between, now we established the values for FY, or fiscal year 2004, which was 2003 calendar year. So those, you know, the assessment that we have today are really based on that snapshot of that April 1, 03.
Right.
And what we're looking at today are properties that sold, say, in January 2007. So you have its assessed value established in 03 divided by a sales price of that property that transferred in January of 07. For instance, the 66% means that house is assessed at $66,000. It sells for $100,000. So the ratio at that point would be 66%.
So that 66% is determined just based on the sampling of houses that are currently selling, properties that are currently selling?
Yeah, the state does a annual, what they call an annual ratio study. They send me copies of every transfer that takes place. I qualify them. I qualify them monthly. So when I say qualifying them, I mean if it's an arm's length transaction, not a, you know, a conveyance of a property from, you know, interfamily, mother to son, husband to wife. Those are basically zero balance transfers that many times don't, you know, qualify as an arm's length transaction. So I send back all the sales that are good, that are usable, and then they study them from July 1 to June 30th of each year. And then annually they send me a report and say, well, Mr. Sturgis, the town of Cape Elizabeth has an assessment ratio of 84%. And then they ask me, what do you declare? and I can declare higher than that. I do, by 10, I can declare as much as 10% higher than that. I do that right now because it maximizes our exemptions that the taxpayers get for veterans and homestead primarily that are adjusted by the ratio. So they let me know what it's going to be, and then I ultimately verify it, and I can contest it, but generally we're in agreement because I'm sending them the same sales that I use. But looking at them right now, I don't see, you know, I don't see anything that has trended that shows me that we're going to pop back above 70 anytime soon.
Is there a minimum number of sales or a minimum percentage of sales based on the total number of properties in town that are considered to be a representative sampling to be able to come to a statistically justifiable conclusion that the ratio is less than 70%?
I think that's a great question, and it does depend upon the market, depends upon the town. Some towns do not have sales, and they use whatever was submitted that year. We have a fairly active market, so we have the luxury of having usually a pretty darn good sampling. In Cape Elizabeth, approximately 300 to 400 sales take place in a year. In the boom times, you know, 2 years ago, we were close to 400 sales. This year, I think we're looking at about 340 sales overall, about 10% of the improved properties in town. That's a pretty good sampling, if you think about that. Every 10 years, every house by that number changes hands in Cape. You know, it doesn't happen really like that, but the numbers work out that way. So that's a darn good sampling. When I was appraising real estate early in the 90s, some towns would be happy to find three in, you know, that were useful sales. So, but it's annual, like I say, it's an annual analysis that they perform, I perform, and they use a good sampling as best as they can, and it gives us an understanding for that year. And, you know, based on that ratio, they determine how much they're going to provide us for tree growth reimbursement and multiple other avenues. And if you drop below it, they penalize you by not giving you as much money and other areas that the state tries to get you to comply with their law. Is that helpful?
That's helpful, yes. Thank you. Just in case it saves you a little bit of work, my house hasn't changed in value.
That's only the second time I've heard that.
To Councilor Lynch's and the rest of the But thank you.
You're very welcome. Any other questions?
Anybody? Thanks, Matt.
Thank you very much.
Nice job. I think one thing that people need to understand, and I think most people do, but just in case you don't, just because the assessment of your home value changes, it does not mean your taxes go up. It just means the equilibrium throughout the town for values is adjusted. Tax rates are determined by spending and revenue figures. So just think that's an important clarification. Okay, now we'll...
Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
Just to clarify that point. That's a true statement if everybody's house goes up proportionately in value.
Well, no.
But to the extent that if the sort of rough rule of thumb that our assessor gave us, that sort of a third go up, a third stay the same, and a third go down, recognizing that that's not a statistically anticipated exact outcome. But under that scenario, those whose increase in value will, in fact, go we'll see an increase in their tax payment.
Correct. Some will see an increase, some will see a decrease, some will stay the same. But the point I'm trying to make is just because there's a 34% gap, if you will, or delta between assessed value and market value, doesn't mean your taxes are going to go up 34% when the change takes place. But
correct.
You also made a true statement, so thank you very much. Okay, we will move on to citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. Would anybody like to make a comment on anything that's not on the agenda this evening? Okay. We'll move on to item number 62-2007. Consideration of the transfer of special amusement permit for the Inn by the Sea property. Do we have a motion on the subject?
So moved.
Okay. Yeah. Is there a second?
Second.
Jim. Any discussion? Okay, all in favor? It's unanimous. Item number 63-2007, public hearing and possible vote regarding proposed amendments to the ordinances drafted in response to the town council referral of request for changes to accommodate an elder care facility. We have a motion.
I would like to move that we open it for public discussion or public hearing. Is that what we need to do, or I can address the...
I guess we don't need a motion, thanks. Okay, so it's, who would like to speak about this? Oh, did you have some comments, Jim?
I can address that.
Okay, thank you.
You may recall that the ordinance committee was asked by the town council to consider two zoning ordinance amendments that were recommended by the planning board. These proposed amendments are to accommodate renovation and new construction at the former Viking nursing facility on Scott Dyer Road, and the ordinance committee did do this on March 16. The first of the ordinances for which amendment is proposed is found in section 19-6-3, subsection E, number 2, and I quote, "The maximum number of dwelling units per area," end quote. Under the current ordinance, elder care facilities are allowed to have one unit per 3,500 square feet, or one bed per 2,500 square feet of net residential area, whichever is less. The ordinance committee recommends that the ordinance be changed to read, and I quote, "One unit per 2,500 square feet, or one bed per 2,100 square feet," end quote. This will allow the developer to effectively increase density at the site by building a two-story structure where the one-story portion of the existing facility currently sits, and also by slightly decreasing the size of the building footprint. Do you want to deal with these proposed ordinance changes separately, or do you want me to go through them both, and then we can discuss them separately, or how would you like them presented?
Yeah, I think I'd like you to go through them both, and then
okay.
We can discuss them.
The other proposed amendment pertains to wetlands proximity. Our current wetland zoning ordinances were enacted after the Viking facility was built. And because new construction is being proposed that will exceed the building volume or area increase limit of 25% as currently prescribed in our critical wetland zones, it's necessary to amend the ordinance in order to allow the proposed project to happen. The ordinance committee therefore recommends that section 19-4-5, subsection A, paragraph number 3, be amended by adding the following sentence, quote, "However, a single-story building that A, is connected to public sewer, and B, is not a single-family home, may increase its volume or floor area by no more than 80% of its pre-expansion volume or floor area, so long as there is no expansion of the building footprint as it existed as of the date this is adopted." I think it's important to note that the proposed project actually does decrease the building footprint and also the area of impervious surface at the site. So in that respect, it would be an improvement over what is there now and what has been there since the Viking was built. That's my presentation.
Thank you, Jim. Appreciate that.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
Could I just ask one question? And the vote was unanimous?
Unanimous.
Of the ordinance committee.
Okay.
Excellent. Do we have anybody in the audience that would like to speak to this particular issue? Okay, do we have a motion to, do we need a motion to approve the...
I would move that we approve the adoption of both amendment changes as just discussed.
Second.
As presented.
Okay. Any
Can
discussion?
Can I ask a question?
Yes.
Is this for this particular case, or this would change the wording always on these?
It would change the ordinance.
Permanently.
Okay. David?
Could we ask our town planner a question or two?
Sure.
Thank you.
Good evening.
Good evening. Maureen, it looks like the way this is proposed, that a residence can increase its floor area or volume by no more than 25%. A commercial establishment can increase its volume or floor area by up to 80% under the conditions.
Yes, but...
Of the proposed amendment.
But the 80% would be only when you're not exceeding your existing building footprint, whereas the 25% includes the opportunity to expand your building footprint by up to 25% as long as you're meeting the other restrictions.
So it's basically, you're adding a second floor?
Yes.
So a residence can expand its footprint, but a commercial building cannot?
A commercial building could expand their footprint, but they would then be under the 25% expansion. If you want to expand and you don't need to expand your footprint and you're on the public sewer, you have the opportunity to expand up to 80%. If you are going to expand your footprint, you're capped at the 25%.
How does this affect a single-story home that wants to put on a second floor?
It doesn't affect it at all because the amendment is targeted solely towards non-single-family structures.
So a single-family, one-story home would not be able to add a second floor and basically double its...
They could go to
volume and floor area.
They could go to the zoning board and ask for an expansion of up to 40%. They could also go to the zoning board and ask for variance. I believe there's one single-family home in town that was able to obtain the variance under that criteria. But it's a different approach, and it's a harder approach.
For?
Single-family homes.
And I think that's really sort of where my thinking is going, is why would we make it harder for somebody who owns a small home, one story, who wants to stay in their home and add a second story? Why would we make it harder for them to do that than we're making it for a commercial establishment to add a second story?
I think the planning board was the crafter of that particular proposal. And when the Viking came forward and we understood they had a density problem, we shortly thereafter discovered that not only did they have a density problem, they also had a problem with the wetlands regulations. And the planning board was willing to consider curing that problem as well, but they were very cognizant of the fact that wetlands regulations are dearly held in this town. And they had no desire to open up that door any more than they absolutely had to, which was why they wrote an amendment that they felt would have very little applicability and would not trigger a widespread shift in wetland protection policy. That's why the amendment before you really is fairly narrowly crafted, and it's intentionally so.
Well, I'm not... just to be clear with my questions, I'm not going to oppose the amendment of the ordinance, but it seems to me that if the town is willing to make it acceptable for a commercial establishment to add a second story, that somebody who has a small home in Cape Elizabeth who wants to stay in it and add a second story, if they meet the other criteria here that won't impact wetlands because they're on the sewer and they're staying within their building footprint, that they ought to be allowed to do that. Now, I realize I'm not proposing an amendment for us to consider at this point. I'd just like to suggest that perhaps we encourage the planning board or the town planner to consider that issue, because I see no reason for us to favor the expansion of a commercial establishment over a residence.
Mary Ann.
If I might just comment, and I do it in the context of the comprehensive plan, which we've just finished drafting, a citizens committee that had two counselors on it, there was identified in that work a need for this kind of housing. So I don't view this particularly as a commercial establishment so much as answering a housing need in town. And I think on the other issue, it was also, I think, very clear as we were doing the comprehensive plan that people do not want to erode the wetlands protections, as Maureen has said. And if you were to make that change for single-family homes, you would be opening it up to the whole town. So I'm hoping we can just focus tonight on not what it doesn't do, because it's not changing anything for the single-family homes, as you know. It's just doing something different so we can begin to address an identified need in the elder care housing. So I'll be supporting it for that reason. I think it's very consistent with the comprehensive plan that's been drafted that's really identified that as a housing need.
And just to be clear, I mean, I recognize it as a need as well, and for that reason, I'll support it. But I'd also like to see the opportunity for people who live in 700, 800,000 square foot homes who want to stay in them, who can't afford to make another lateral move in Cape Elizabeth, to be able to add on to their home by going vertically when they can't expand their footprint.
Sarah?
Will this amendment affect all commercial properties or just residential ones? In other words, could the people in the town center all put a second story on?
Well, I don't believe there's any structure in the town center, with the exception of the high school, that would be non-conforming as to the wetland regulations. So it's not just, and to echo what Councilor Lynch said, it isn't a commercial amendment. It's an amendment that affects any building that's not a single-family home. But it also only affects buildings that are within the critical wetland buffer. And I think the last time we estimated that was approximately 680 structures. So most of the structures in Cape Elizabeth are single-family homes. So there's not a lot of structures left that are not single-family homes and in the 250-foot buffer that would have an opportunity to connect to the sewer and expand their building beyond what they've already done. But any building that meets those criteria could potentially come forward with that proposal.
Anybody else?
Can I just add one other point? And I think it's very important, the idea that the building has to be connected to the sewer, because this was one of the things that the Comprehensive Plan Committee talked about, that it's so important for environmental protection to encourage connection to the sewer, and to the extent you can get away from septic systems, which all ultimately fail at some point. So I view this as something that really enhances our environmental protection.
Okay. We will take a vote then. All in favor of the elder care wetland zoning amendments?
Did we have the public hearing? Oh. Yes.
I asked if anybody wanted to speak.
I'm sorry. I didn't know if anybody had come.
Nobody did. Yeah. All in favor? Thank you. Okay, now we'll move to item number 64-2007, and it's a public hearing and possible vote on proposed traffic calming policy. Cynthia.
Oh, I'm used to pressing my button.
I was ready.
Statehouse. yes, good evening, everyone. I am pleased to present item 64-2007 as the chairperson of the traffic calming committee. I'm going to give just a little brief background and invite some other people to provide some information about the policy before we actually have the public hearing, so if you'll just bear with me. In February 2006, the Town Council included as one of its goals to explore opportunities for road safety. And in April of 2006, the Ordinance Committee, which I might add, it was my first ordinance committee meeting as a town councilor. Councilor Lynch was the chair. We recommended to the town council at large to appoint a group to gather input, both citizen and professional, on the advisability of a traffic, of implementing traffic calming measures. And on April 10th, 2006, the town council voted to execute that recommendation, and in fact, a committee was appointed by then council chair David Backer. The committee consisted and continues to consist of myself, Richard Berman, who is going to speak with you soon, Elizabeth Brogan, representing a bike and road safety group, Carol Fritz, who is in the audience with us tonight, I might note, and was then a town counselor, the town manager, the public works director, Bob Malley, Maureen, our town planner, and Chief Williams. We, as a committee, just for some statistics, we had nine meetings, one public forum, site walk. We tried to encourage as much public input as we can. We ran six stories in the Courier, and an ongoing story was on the website inviting the public to provide comments. We received approximately 45 separate pieces of communication, and 18 people attended the public forum. The committee had three goals. We wanted to first develop a traffic calming policy. That's the subject of tonight's public hearing. And then we also had two other goals. One is to recommend specific methods and specific areas for enhanced bikeway and pedestrian safety. And the third goal was to identify make specific recommendations for the enhancement of pedestrian friendliness in the town center. Tonight, the public hearing is just limited to our first goal, which is to draft a traffic calming policy for consideration by the town council. And Maureen first is going to speak briefly about how the draft policy, which you all have in your packet, how the proposed traffic calming policy is consistent with the comprehensive plan, just so we're clear about that. Richard Berman is going to present the actual policy and how it works very briefly. Chief Williams is going to give some information about the need, why there is a need for a policy, and talk about how he's going to implement the policy using the defined term neighborhood. Our work is not done. We still will be moving forward on our second and third goals, as I mentioned. Our next meeting is scheduled for Friday, April 27th at 8:45 a.m. for anyone who'd like to join us. And I just want to thank the members of the committee and the staff who helped us. It was a great group. I look forward to continued work, and I'm sure that Mr. Berman or Maureen or the chief or myself can hopefully answer some questions. I know some citizens have expressed some concerns about the policy because unfortunately there are certain areas in town that are difficult. It's really an enforcement issue for a lot of people. They just want people not to speed. And I think the traffic policy cannot make people stop speeding. Obviously, stricter enforcement can, and we're encouraging that, and I think the chief will speak to that. But I'm hoping that a majority of people will find our work to be satisfactory. And on that note, I would invite our town planner to just briefly address our policy and how it could coexist with the comprehensive plan.
There have been a lot of comments made about the policy, and I'm going to just go over, you all have this, the draft comprehensive plan. The draft comprehensive plan specifically recommends that the town consider adopting a traffic calming policy. It also specifically recommends the town create a master plan for sidewalks and bikeways. In my opinion, the plan is consistent with the draft policy that you have before you. The one other thing I just want to go over briefly is what the road classification system in Cape Elizabeth is. We have a local road classification system, which is independent of the classification system that the state uses for the purpose of handing out funds to maintain roads. The top category is an arterial. We only have one road in that category, and that's Route 77. And I think most people would agree that there's no other road in town like Route 77. The second level is a collector road, and those roads are roads that are also, their primary function is to carry traffic from one part of town to the other, and they tend to be higher volume. We have another type of road that also, its primary function is to carry traffic from one side of the town to the other, but they tend to be lower volume roads, primarily because there's not as much development off of those roads. We have a separate category for those called rural connectors. So really, the skeleton of the town's road network is, are the arterial, the collectors, and the rural connectors. And then the bottom two are feeder streets, which are basically the bigger neighborhood roads. The Broad Cove Road is a good example, where you have a lot of other roads coming off of it. And then the vast majority of roads in the town, probably 95% of them, are what we call local roads, local and private roads. It's just important to keep in mind that, I know there's been some conversation about what is the function of roads, and I did go back to my practice of local government planning book, which was put together by the International City Management Association in cooperation with the American Planning Association. And they talk about street purposes being, in addition to carrying automobiles and trucks, other purposes of a road can be vehicle parking, motorcycle and bicycle traffic, opening up links to the community. It can be a place where you put major public utilities, public landscaping. A road can structure a neighborhood. It can form the entrance to homes, and it can be a visual framework for area. So if you think of this whole range of functions that a road has, roads where the predominant responsibility is carrying traffic, basically major movements of traffic within the town or to other parts of town, those are the roads that are the arterials, the rural connectors, and the collectors. And then the roads that have typically shorter length trips, trips of less than a mile, where their primary function is to provide access to the adjacent land use, those are your local roads and to a little lesser extent your feeder roads. So just to kind of help you with some of the comments that were made, I thought that might be useful information.
Thank you, Maureen.
Can I ask a question?
Maureen, you're not off the hook.
Just one question. Where does Oakhurst Road fall?
I believe Oakhurst Road is a feeder road, and I can check that in the zoning ordinance. The road classifications are formally adopted by the town and are listed in Appendix C of the zoning ordinance. So I can double-check that for you, but my guess would be that Oakhurst would fall within the feeder road classification.
You could double-check.
I will do that.
Can I ask you a question? I'm curious where Sawyer Road falls.
Sawyer Road is a rural connector.
Now, what if a road sort of has two characters or two functions, like Sawyer, one part seems to me to connect two towns, and another part is sort of a rural neighborhood road. Can you subdivide a road in classification, or that doesn't?
Most roads have multiple purposes. You know, if you think of Route 95, 95 is pretty much a single-purpose road to get you from one place to another, and it has limited access, so it doesn't serve other functions. But most town roads serve a multiple of functions, and what you do when you classify is you try to look at the function that tends to predominate. And yes, people live on Sawyer Road, and they use it as their primary access to their properties. But Sawyer Road, if you look at a map of the town of Cape Elizabeth, and the comprehensive plan has, I think, a great map of the road system, you can see that there's a skeleton network of roads that help you get from one part of town to the other. And in my opinion, Sawyer Road is adequately, it's correctly classified as a road that you need to get from one part of town to the other.
Both parts of Sawyer Road?
Yes, the whole length, the north, south, and the east-west length, the whole thing.
One is this way and one is...
Right, and the whole thing is classified as a rural connector.
Okay, you have the questions for Maureen? Who's up next? Richard.
My name is Richard Berman. I live in Hanifer Cove Road and on the committee. And what I'll do is try to walk you through this. Let me just move this around so I'm back and forth. When we started doing this part of our committee work, the traffic calming part, we didn't want to reinvent the wheel, so we started gathering together different traffic calming policies in different cities and towns. We looked at Portland's, Essex Junction, Baltimore County, Kent, Town of Brookline, and Woodbury, Minnesota, for instance, to just kind of look at all the traffic calming policies that were out there that we could find. When we looked at all those, there were a few concepts that really came out of those. The first one was just what Maureen was just talking about, the different types of road classifications and what were the purposes of the roads. The second one was different levels of improvements for traffic calming, and I'll go through these, but we've broken down passive, standard, and physical, and I'll go through those with you. But that was a concept. Another concept, the third concept, was the measurements they used. So really they looked at speed, volume of traffic, the amount of traffic, and then pedestrian conflicts, like pedestrian generators, you might say, schools, playgrounds, and density. So those were the three things they looked at on the measurements. And then the last one, the fourth one, was neighborhood buy-in. All of these policies really had to have the majority of the neighborhood they were affecting buy into it, so that it wasn't just one person that wanted speed bumps and everybody else, you know, so you wouldn't cause conflict. So those were some of the concepts. And before we get into the body of the policy, let me just spend a minute with the different kind of measures. The first one is a passive measure. And again, I'll put this in context, but just for right now, these are things like speed notification signboards. And we've been talking about, you know, this is the signboard where you drive by and it says you're going this speed and you check and you're, whoa. We have a big one. We're going to have to get a small one, a smaller one. So there's costs associated, by the way, there's costs associated with all this stuff. So just be aware of that. Neighborhood mailings. This is just if a neighborhood's having problems, so one of the things you can do is mail out to all the people, make them aware of the problem, and so forth and so on. Police enforcement, adopt a cone. This is where they put out these different cones in the right of ways, you know, children cones or whatever. And then looking at putting in maybe pedestrian and bicycle safety improvements, evaluation for these things. So these are all passive. They don't cost as much as some of the others, and it's the first thing one can do. Then you get into standard measures. These are a little more, not drastic, but, you know, involve more money, they involve more change. So this would be putting turn restrictions in some roads or some areas, pavement markings, also including plantings. And then finally, you get into physical measures. These are the most aggressive and the most expensive. These would include speed tables, chokers, like an island in the middle of the road, or narrowing in the road, chokers or pedestrian refuge islands, traffic circles, or those things, and again, plantings. So you can see they go from kind of, inexpensive, not much change, to the physical thing, to physical changes. Don't be intimidated by this. I was. This is just a graphic that'll help us walk through the policy. And I don't know if you just, you all have that policy right in front of you right now?
Yes.
Okay, so maybe the best thing is just for me to quickly go right through it. It won't take too very long at all. The policy is written up so that if a person, if you're in your neighborhood and you feel you have a real problem with traffic and it needs calming, you have to initiate this request. Probably you'll call up Mike McGovern and he'll say, we have a policy. Send you to policy probably is how it's going to happen. But the person has to put it in writing to seek some traffic calming, giving their name and everything else. Once that the police chief receives that, they will schedule a speed, so a written request is the first thing. Then the police department does a speed study of the area. Okay. basically. Now, if the speed study indicates that it's five, they look at the speeds, they do, and if people are traveling over 5 miles per hour, then you go down this way. If they're not, if they're traveling at the speeds of less than 5 miles per hour, then that area is eligible for passive measures only. So then you go into these passive measures, and you work with the police chief, and we try these different things to calm down the traffic in that neighborhood. If, by the way, that's number three, you can see that. We do say right after that, there's a note that arterial collectors and rural connector roads are intended to efficiently move automobile traffic, just what Maureen was saying before. And they're only eligible for passive measures only if the speed is over 5 miles per hour. Okay. So in this case, if it's not a major road, even if it's under 5 miles per hour, it can get passive things. If it's one of those major roads, it has to be over 5 miles per hour to be eligible for passive measures. Now, if the speed is over 5 miles per hour, then the neighborhood could get together, that person that's initiating it, and has to get 51% of the affected neighborhood to say, yeah, we got a problem here. If they don't get 51%, again, it goes to passive. That's all it's eligible for is passive. It means that, you know, there's not a bigger concern in the neighborhood as you might think. If they do get over 51%, the majority of the people, then the police will, the police department will do a volume study. So now we talked about speed, now we're getting into this other thing, volume. So the volume study is done. Again, this costs money. If it's less than 100 cars, and by the way, this came, the 100 cars came, I believe it was from a study that was done on Spurwink Woods, when how many cars would affect Sawyer Road at that intersection, so there's a lot of things. So we use that as a benchmark. And so we said, if they have to look at it 100 cars. If it's under 100 cars, it goes to the passive. You might have 51% of the people saying, wow, we need something here. But there's no volume, and there's some speed, so it's passive. If it's over 100 trips, then we get into the police chief will look to see if there's now this third element. Is there a pedestrian generator? So is there a school? Is there a park? Is there no sidewalk? Okay. If you've got over 100 cars and they're over 5 mile an hour speeding, and there's one of these, then it goes down to this one. If there isn't this pedestrian generator, then you go into these standard measures. You following me so far?
Yes. Right. Mm-hmm. Can I ask one question?
Sure.
100 trips per what? Is there a time frame or all day or?
In one
during
morning,
the peak hour.
The peak hour.
For the peak.
For an hour, thank you.
The peak hour.
Peak. And
hour.
The peak hour is,
not
I think,
just any
it's
hour.
Five.
Busy time. The busiest time. Thank you.
Usually that's, I think, coming back or going to work. Okay, so now if there is over 100 cars, so now we've got speed, we've got volume, we need 75%. Whoops, and we have a, we have a school zone or a pedestrian generator, like a park, and there is no sidewalk. Then the neighborhood needs to get 75%, so the majority, including everybody on whatever's going to be done, their approval to get into, to start to look at more of a physical thing. If they don't get the 75%, again, it goes to the standard now, the standard measures. If they do, then it comes to the town council, because you're talking serious dollars here, and you're talking design changes, you're talking a lot of things. So if you've got over 100 cars, they're speeding, you get over 75%, then the council gets a chance to look at this and decide whether it's in your budget to make these changes, et cetera. If the town does not approve physical changes, then that neighborhood is eligible for the standard measures. If the council approves it, then it would be the police chief in the neighborhood who would work on these physical things and come up with recommendations. So that's kind of how it goes from, you know, goes right through the whole policy. At the end of this is those, these are the passive controls I was talking about. It's more clearly defined in that, the standards, and finally the physical. And then we have some, at the end, just definitions for what is a speed study and what is a neighborhood. So I know there's a lot more information in here, but I wanted to, I don't know what your timing is, but that's...
Mary Ann, just to answer your initial question about what Oakhurst Road was, I, according to the draft, May 25th, 2006, transportation section of the comprehensive plan, Oakhurst Road is a feeder road.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. And Sawyer Road is a rural connector. And thank you very much, Richard. That was excellent.
So, just to further clarify, you know, the arterial collectors and rural connectors are identified in the traffic study itself, the policy.
I saw that, Richard. My only concern was the language said that it includes these roads. It was kind of broad language, which led me to believe that perhaps there were other roads not listed. It says these roads include.
These are those.
But if it says these are, these roads are.
Okay.
Then you're not left wondering, yeah, are there other roads?
By the way, we, you know, this is good. We, I don't know if we're really ready to vote on this tonight because we consider this still a draft. Mm-hmm. We wanted to have a public hearing, get more. We've also gotten input from professional traffic planners. And so what we intend to do after this is to tweak it and polish it up and then be ready for vote. So that's a good comment.
Yeah, well, thank you. We may or may not vote on it, but thank you for that comment. I would just like to say before I invite the chief up that the attempt of the policy is to balance the desire of many residents to have some control over traffic calming and to feel that there is something that they can do, to balance that with the needs of the town to have a consistent and fair and reasonably efficient way to implement such a policy, taking into the needs of both the town as a whole and the individuals who might have some concerns. So there really has to be some buy-in from the concerned citizens and the neighborhoods. But if in fact there is, then the town responds appropriately and in our view in a meaningful way. And now if Chief Williams would please.
Good evening. For the past about 17 years, I've been in the administration end of it and can say that mostly in the spring and in the fall, spring when people get outside, fall when school starts, we tend to get our complaints on speeding. And those complaints will come to my office either via Mike or Public Works. And what we'll do is we'll do a speed survey in that particular area, see what we can do to bring the speed down if there is a problem. And we've also had people call us right up and not even want a speed survey. They want speed bumps immediately. We want speed bumps. And I'll tell them, I'm sorry, but we don't do speed bumps. And the next call goes to Bob or to Mike. I'm not sure whether it goes up or where it goes sideways, but they might not be happy with my answer and they'll go to somebody else. So the traffic calming policy before you tonight is one that gives us some consistency, I think gives the public a little chart to go by. They know where they're going to fall in that particular policy. It also gives the department heads and myself a clear understanding of where we go once we find out the measurement. And so I really think that it's a good tool to have. I know that in some of the correspondence that was given to the council. There was one mention of a car that sits in a particular town, sits right there. I know that vehicle quite well, and that's because those residents in that particular area pay for that car and that officer. That's why it sits right there. So, I mean, if I had that luxury of having an area in the community that wanted to pay for an officer, we could do that. We could handle that. But I'd just like to bring that one thing up, that's all. And with regards to the neighborhood definition, we tried to make that broad enough. So the Public Works Director, myself, the representative from that area, could sit down and we could craft that area, whether it bring in a map from GIS, from Maureen, so we could look at that and see what particular part of that neighborhood is affected, and so we could craft that. I really don't think, in speaking with my colleagues on the policy committee, that we tried our best, and we tried to craft it, so we gave everybody an input once they made that complaint and we got down to that specific area. If we can craft that a little better, so be it. That's not a problem. We try to do the best that we could. I hope that answers the neighborhood definition.
Thank you very much, Chief Williams.
Thanks.
Well, that's all we wanted to present to you before the public hearing. Thank you for allowing us to do that.
Thank you, Cynthia. Okay, the public hearing is now open. Are there any citizens that would like to speak on the traffic calming policy? Yes, sir.
I'm Gary Beckwith. I live on Oakwood Road. You frequently see me walking, bicycling, and I was somewhat involved with the committee. Lived in the same long time. My wife and I celebrated living in the same house 50 years at Christmas. The point is, you have a number of things, and the main thing I see from this is education. And it's an ongoing thing, educating the driving public, the walking public. And the other thing is enforcement. Those are the two key elements to trying to maintain. And I'm sure that Mike McGovern realizes a young family with young kids, they become quite vocal. When the kids grow up and run their own machines, they're no longer concerned about the speed, but it is an ongoing thing. And so the ongoing part is still ongoing education to the public and ongoing enforcement.
Thank you, Mr. Beckwith. Would anybody else like to make a comment? Okay, do we have a motion by the council regarding this item?
Well, I would move to first amend the policy to change the word include on page 1 in paragraph 3 to the word are. So I would say these roads are. That's.
Do you want to make a motion?
I would move to accept or adopt the policy as amended.
Okay, do we have a second?
Second.
Ann? Okay, any discussion? Michael?
Yeah, I just wanted to mention that this is one of the responsibilities of this committee. In addition, the committee is also looking at some pedestrian improvements. They've looked at the intersection out here at my favorite intersection that I keep pointing to, Shore Road, Scott Dyer Road. They've recommended that we consider an off-the-road path between Fort Williams and eventually the center of town. They're looking at that. And the reason I mention all that, because, you know, if anyone does have some suggested changes to this policy, the committee, you know, I think you can still approve it tonight if you desire, and the committee can still look at some of these issues, and when they come back with their other recommendations, could also recommend some technical amendments to this as well.
Thank you, Michael, for the clarification. Councilors, any discussion? Mary Ann?
First of all, I want to thank Cynthia and everyone else who worked on this. I am so excited that we are talking about calming traffic. As someone who walks every day on many of the roads that are listed as arterial collector and rural connector roads, we really do have to educate drivers. But I have just a couple of questions, but I'm about 95% enthusiastic and really grateful for all the work that the entire committee and you, Cynthia, put into this, so thank you for that. Just a couple questions. On the list of physical alteration control measures, we again use some expansive language. We say some examples of measures are the following. My question is, are lights and stop signs physical alteration control measures? I'd like to make sure that those two tools are excluded from the definition of a physical alteration control measure, because if they are not excluded, we could not put lights out here at that intersection that Michael keeps pointing to all day. But I think it would fall within the, perhaps the natural interpretation of the physical alteration control measure, which right now says it's a design change in the road infrastructure that creates partial barriers or interruptions in the flow of traffic. So I'd just like to make sure at some point that, and we don't necessarily have to amend it, but I just want to make sure there's a common understanding.
Yeah, it's not the intent at all that this policy limits or diminishes in any way the authority of the town council. So if the town council wants to put lights at that intersection, then the town council will and can. This policy is simply a mechanism for
citizens.
Residents or citizens to begin a process to evaluate traffic in their neighborhood and then ultimately achieve some resolution. And if it gets to physical alteration control measures, then it would be subject to a town council approval, and those may include lights or stop signs.
Okay.
But if the town council, in its great wisdom, wants to
or
put up a stop sign or lights, then we don't have to go through this policy.
Okay. And that's a couple of the other questions I had. For instance, what if we had 70% neighborhood support, and we're way down here on the flow chart? This policy would not preclude the council from acting if, in its wisdom, it thought it necessary to act, even though there was 70% neighborhood support instead of 75.
The council can
only. And I'm not trying to change this. I just want to make sure that we're all sort of clear for the record that this policy doesn't preclude action just because one of these thresholds
That's
has
correct.
Not been met.
Yeah, I mean, that would be an interesting town council meeting. If for some reason, whether it be a specific recommendation by the chief of police because of extraordinary safety concerns or for whatever, you can just imagine a special circumstance would arise that would motivate the town council to implement a physical measure, then I don't see any hindrance by virtue of adopting this policy.
Okay. And then if I might, just one last thing, which is, I think, more a comment, and that is, and mostly for Neil, but on the passive traffic control measures, we identify police enforcement as a passive traffic control measure. I just, again, want to make sure we're really clear that we don't have to be in this chart for the police to do the enforcement.
No, yes. The expectation is that the police will enforce the speed limits regardless of anyone.
Okay. Because we all know
yes.
that in those places where they are enforced, whether it's in neighborhoods that pay for police service, or in places, there are certain places in South Portland that, you know, you just know not to speed because the enforcement is rigorous. That's probably our best tool, so just want to make sure that we're not forgetting that piece
Thank
of
you
it.
For those comments.
Dan.
I think Councilor Lynch brings up some excellent points. I have one additional comment on her second point, which was whether the council should feel bound or not bound by this policy. And I agree, the council can basically decide to put a stop sign on every corner in Cape Elizabeth if it wants to, and it wouldn't have to go through this policy. I don't think that's going to happen, but I would say that I think the point of having a council policy is that it provides some strong guidance for the council, and I would not want, at least speaking for myself, I would not want citizens to feel that because the council can ultimately do what it wants on things like stop signs and whatever, that they should just feel like, why bother having a policy and just ignore the policy? And the point of having the policy is to provide a standard way for citizens to initiate requests, and I think I will feel that is the appropriate way to initiate requests. There may be exceptions to the rule, but I would look first to this policy if it is adopted as an indication of what citizens would want.
Sarah.
We all got this letter from Ms. Esposito and Mr. Flimpton, who live in Thousand Sawyer Road. And reading through it, it sounded like one of their major concerns was process and how you arrived here. And I guess they felt like there wasn't enough citizen representation on drafting it or vetting it or input or public hearings, or they have a list of things. And I'm just curious, when you read this, what your response was.
My response was that, you know, I checked, and as I mentioned earlier on in my sort of historical rendition of how we came to be, it was the ordinance committee who recommended to the town council that a committee made up of these specific people be formed to study traffic calming, and we were each asked to serve on the committee, and every one of us is a resident of Cape Elizabeth with the exception of the town planner. However, that being said, there was also numerous invitations made by the committee through the six various articles in the Courier and the ongoing web site and the invitation to attend the public forum for public input. So I guess I would disagree that the process was in any way flawed. I feel that we really opened up the process as much as we could, and I think, unfortunately, Mr. Plimpton and Ms. Esposito, who I know and are friendly with, I think are frustrated because they live on a road that is very difficult to implement any sort of physical measure because it is a rural connector road, and it's limited by its, you know, it's a narrow road with a lot of brush and rocks and, you know, it'd be great if we could put a sidewalk on every road in Cape Elizabeth, but the costs are extraordinary, and the town only owns a certain amount of property, you know, on the road. It's not like we have this unlimited ability just to put down sidewalks if the town doesn't own the road. So I'm sorry that they're not happy with the process, but I don't agree that the process in any way excluded people or was somehow set up to exclude public comment, because it was a process that was ordained by the town council, and people were invited to serve, and those who were invited did serve, and I think served very well.
Mary Ann?
I've read through this, and I share their concern, living on Shore Road now, and formerly living on Mitchell Road, and before that, living on Scott Dyer Road. I seem to always find myself living on Collector Road, so I know what their frustration is, because people just use those roads to get from here to there, and they don't think about the kids in the neighborhoods and the cyclists and everyone using the road. And so that's why I get back to enforcement being so key. And, you know, particularly Neil mentioned spring and fall, and hopefully we can be doing as much enforcement as we can on those roads, and if the neighbors think that Sawyer Road is a particular problem. You don't have to write a whole lot of tickets before people start to get the message and the word gets out, and they slow down at least for a couple of months, so.
And I would just,
go ahead.
If I may just make one final comment. I mean, it was road safety in part that motivated me to get on the town council in the first place, and it was my idea to put explore opportunities for road safety in the town council goal. And I live on Shore Road, and I have young kids, so I'm very sensitive to traffic calming. And I'm optimistic, based on the studies that we did in our committee and the work that was done, that the passive measures, they shouldn't be seen necessarily as just a non-effective way to address traffic calming. I mean, the point is that those passive measures should, in fact, result in calmed traffic. So I'm optimistic and at least want to give the policy a chance to see if in Mr. Plimpton's neighborhood we set out the signboard, we send out neighborhood mailings, we put some police enforcement there, we adopt a cone, that those things in fact may address some of the concerns. I'm hopeful that they do.
Okay. Any other comments? David?
When I first read this, my initial, I mean, I was sort of left with a question mark hanging in my mind as to whether or not this was really a useful tool or whether it was sort of a needless exercise in the council creating a committee and a process that might not be of particular benefit to the town and the citizens. So I was very interested, Chief Williams, to hear your comments and to hear your sentiment that this would be a valuable tool from an enforcement standpoint, from a town administration standpoint, and that there is value to the town in having this policy. So I'm certainly willing to support it, but with the hope that if we find through citizen comment or otherwise that it seems to be a policy without any real effectiveness, that we won't be reluctant to revisit it as necessary from time to time, whether it's a year from now or even sooner if necessary.
Oh, I have absolutely no reluctance to revisit it. I mean, I think it's a work in process. I mean, it's the first policy that Cape Elizabeth will enact, and I'm sure it'll get massaged and improved over time.
Yeah, and I think that's a great way to put it, Councilor Dale. I think that this should very much be viewed as a work in progress. And I'm mindful of the fact that Mr. Berman even acknowledged that as submitted, it was a draft not necessarily for approval tonight, but for further comment and refinement. And I do have a number of suggested sort of wordsmithing that I'd like to submit at some point. And if the town manager suggested that there might be a means to, for sort of technical amendments, I don't know to whom those should be submitted, but I'm...
True. But, just send them to me and I'll see what they look like. And if they're minor technical, don't change language, we can handle it through the approval of the minutes process. You're planning to do it this next, in the next couple weeks?
They're done.
Give them to Cynthia.
Hand them over. I'll give them to Maureen.
That's great. Okay, thank you. I often say that Councilor Backer, if he wasn't an attorney, should be an English professor, because he's very, very good at it. So, thanks, David.
And we specifically noted in our committee that we anticipate that Councilor Backer would have.
We find this.
Very helpful, clarifying comments, so fulfilled our expectation. Thank you.
Second, only to the critical eye of one or two other unnamed others on the council.
I really want to thank Cynthia for her leadership of this committee, and as well as, I think it's really been a great example of the staff working with citizens. You know, the staff usually doesn't take as large a role on a committee as we did on this one, and, you know, there's been a little criticism for it, and, you know, I understand that, but in this instance, with the technical aspects of it and working with the day-to-day administration of it, I think it was a very wise move to have such a blended committee, and I really want to express my appreciation to all of the citizen members, the staff members, and the leadership of Representative Councilor Dill.
Thank you. Jim?
I'd just like to add my commendation to the committee for its hard work. I attended one of the public forums as 2006 wore down, and I was amazed at that time at how much work had been accomplished up until that time, and now to see this relatively polished product in front of us, it's just amazing to me. I want to thank all the committee who served on that. With that, I'd like to move the question.
That sounds reasonable. I just would like to make one comment, and I would commend the committee as well. I think you've done a great job, and I've lived on some of these very busy roads, and I appreciate all the work you did. It's excellent. So, with that,
I'm sorry, can I make one final comment?
Yes.
And that is the submission of Mary Esposito and David Plimpton. This is an incredibly comprehensive critique and analysis of the road safety working group's process and product. And I respect the fact that they put in a tremendous amount of time and effort to provide the comments they did. And I have no doubt that but for the fact that in one of these submissions, or maybe it was an email, they indicated they would be out of the country tonight, they would be here. Mm-hmm. Tonight, I'm sure, to provide us with a verbal synopsis of what they've given us in writing. And I don't want for a minute for anyone to think that I'm sort of casting this aside as right. as not germane or important in light of the support that I'm going to give to the motion that's in front of us. But rather, I'm supporting it again with Councilor Dill's well-stated comment that it's really a work in progress. And I fully expect that we'll hear further from both Mary Esposito and David Plimpton and others for ways that it can be refined. And I want to thank them for the obvious tremendous amount of time and effort and research that they put in submitting what they have to the council.
Well said. Okay, with that, all in favor of the motion. Now we will move on to item number 65-2007, receipt of annual benchmark study. Mike?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. What I'd like to do, since a couple of councils requested it, is to briefly go through this, and you know, there might be an additional presentation at the public hearing on the budget. In my usual way, I haven't put page numbers, so I'm going to have to go through it page by page. First of all, if you turn to the first page, the one with the picture of the Public Works garage, I think what's notable on this page is our state valuation per capita. We have the highest of the communities we're looking at, which include Cape, Falmouth, Yarmouth, Freeport, Scarborough, Cumberland, South Portland, Windham, Brunswick, and Gorham. We have the highest state valuation per capita, despite having almost no commercial property, which is, you know, which means, you know, that the tax burden that we do have is really being borne by residential homes, and that we have, and obviously, it goes without saying, we have significant valuation in residential homes. The next page lists the full value tax rate, And if you look at the mean for these communities that we're looking at, is 1292. Cape Elizabeth is 1157, or about $1.40 below the mean, which is pretty considerable. Citizens, as a full value tax rate in Cape Elizabeth, pay more than Wyndham and Scarborough, but they pay less than Gorham, Cumberland, Falmouth, Freeport, South Portland, Brunswick, and Yarmouth. And in some of those, by quite a, you know, Yarmouth is about 25% less as a percentage of full value than Cape Elizabeth.
Can you just quickly say what that is?
Yeah, the full value tax rate is if every community did a revaluation at the same time, and you said this is what all the properties are worth, that equalizes the tax rate based on if everything was at full value. You do that by looking at the state valuation. Okay. On the next page, there's a lot of detail here about the circuit breaker program. And I think what's significant here is 874 residential homes benefited and renters from the circuit breaker program. And that's between 20% and 25% of the households in Cape Elizabeth. A pretty significant percentage receive money from the Maine property tax rent and relief program. The average amount received last year from Cape Elizabeth was $725.83. And the deadline for that program is coming up the end of the month. And so really encourage folks to get their applications in.
Mike, do you know off the top of your head what the trigger is? If your property taxes are a certain percentage of your
adjusted gross income. There's information on our website available on this, as is this whole benchmark study. The next page shows assets, balances, tax and lien receivable. What's notable here is the citizens of Cape Elizabeth taxpayers have the best record in the area of paying their taxes on time. There's only less than 1% in taxes and liens receivable as of June 30th, and other communities are as high as heading towards 5%. So citizens do a great job paying their taxes. Our undesignated fund balance is quite a bit below the mean percentage for the area. The only communities with a lower percentage are Wyndham and Yarmouth. All the others are more than Cape Elizabeth.
Some scandalously so.
On the next page, licenses and permits. It's interesting, 0.7% of our total revenues are licenses by permits. The mean is 1.1. Part of that is because we don't have commercial entities paying license fees. The other is, you know, it does show this potential, for example, in the building permit proposal, to have a greater share of our costs paid for. On the next page, the top thing, our investment income, is quite a bit less than the average. That's because we sit on a lot less money than most of those other communities. They're earning more than we are, because they're, as Marianne would say, they're holding taxpayer money that they don't need to hold, or something similar to that effect.
Let's say they're borrowing interest-free from their taxpayers.
Yes. Borrowing interest-free from their taxpayers. Okay. Our intergovernmental revenue is 19.4% of our total revenues. Again, the average for the area is about 27%. On the next page, it's excise taxes per capita. We used to be the highest. And we're dropping. Citizens aren't buying as expensive cars here. Maybe they're a little more fewer expensive cars. Plus, we don't have some of the commercial trucks, for example, that they have in Scarborough, that are registered in Scarborough, that pay quite a bit of excise tax. But overall, that's an area where citizens, the average excise tax per capita is $183 in the region. Cape Elizabeth taxpayers are paying $202 per capita. We collect a lot more in recreation fees than most of the other places. That's because of community services and the pool. Our bonded debt per capita is more than slightly above the average. The average is a little over, it's about $2,100. Ours is $3,100. We have about $1,000 more bonded debt per capita. And that's in part keeping with the philosophy that the citizens who are here today shouldn't have to pay for the improvements that are going to benefit citizens for a long time. On general government, which is everything from assessing, planning, the town office, all of our municipal buildings, the per capita average is $123. In Cape Elizabeth, it's $111. Insurance and employee benefits, we pay less per citizen is $86. The average is $123, so it's significantly less than some of the other communities. Police department, you've got to be a little bit careful here because dispatching is included for some communities and not for the others. That's why I didn't show a mean, because I think the mean would be meaningless. But you can see generally we spend less per capita for police than most places, although Wyndham, Yarmouth, and Freeport surprisingly spend less per capita than we do. The fire department, we spend way less than anyone else. $26.62 for every citizen. The mean in the area is over $62. So we less than half the mean, and we're $8 less than the community nearest to us. Communications, that's for dispatching, where you're in the ballpark in the middle. Public works, where you spend $20 less per capita than the comparable communities. Solid waste, we're above the average by about $12, and the reason for that is we're not doing as much recycling as some of these other communities. The library, we spend about $5 more per capita than the average, $4.50 more than the average. It's a priority. Parks and Recreation, we spend more than anyone else. We spend over double the mean, and that's primarily because of community services and the pool and fitness center, and less so, you know, people always cite Fort Williams, and Fort Williams is a piece of it, but it's a very small piece of it. It's mainly community services and the pool and fitness center. Health and welfare, we spend very little, $5 or so, $4.50 under the average for the region. Debt service, despite the fact we have $1,000 more than the average, we, on a per capita basis for debt service, we're spending about $20 less per capita than the average. Our library, there's various data there on the next page. You know, I think you can read those. On the next page, we start to get into education, and this is all very interesting. General administration. This is like for the superintendent's office and that level of administration. Most schools spend almost $400 per capita. We spend $298 per student, while the mean is $380. So the school department spends far less on general administration than our comparable communities. Similarly, school administration, these are principals. We spend $462. The mean is $482. We're spending $22 less per student on school administrators in the schools than they are in the other school communities. If you look at total administration, we're at $761 per student. The mean is $865. So we're spending, again, $100 less in total administration per student. And when you have, you know, 1,800 students, that adds up you know, to a lot of savings that we're not spending on administration. You know, other places, for example, neighboring communities, one of them is spending on administration $450 more per student than we are. Mm-hmm. Interesting. Instruction, that's where the, you know, the rubber hits the road and all those cliches.
Excuse me, could I just add a comment? Because yeah. I think it's important for people to understand, with talk of consolidation that's going on and regionalization of schools, if you look at our two neighboring school systems, which would be likely school partners for us, they seem to be, well, one of them at least seems to be much higher on administrative costs than ours. So. That is the argument that many have been making, that because of the one-town concept and a variety of other efficiencies that our school system admirably does, our costs for our citizens are somewhat lower than many of our neighbors. So consolidation that would ask for us to get to a 10% lower figure in sort of a blank, as a blanket goal, would be much more difficult for us to attain since we've already attained those efficiencies. Mm-hmm. Sorry, I just had to throw that in.
That's good clarification,
yeah,
Anna,
really
for people
point.
To know.
The next part of the spreadsheet's on instruction. As you can see, that nice little graphic of the teacher there with the responsive student. Cape Elizabeth spent, in its last year's budget, this is, was $6,725 per student for instruction, teachers, that type thing. The mean in the area is $6,874, so we're spending $160 less than the mean. The range in this area is from $8,354 in South Portland down to $5,985 in Wyndham. Again, we're at $6,725. So as far as instruction, we're spending 71% of our budget on instruction, which is the highest percentage of a budget of any community in this comparable group. So if you look at the whole school budget, it's clear their priority is instruction, and it's not other things. One of the reasons for that, though, is, for example, operations. We're spending a full percentage point less as a part of the budget than the comparable communities. Per student, we're spending about $150 less for operations. That's mainly because the elementary and the middle school are all in one building. Mm-hmm. Makes it very efficient to run it, and we're all just running one campus. You know, the one town concept, I think, figures into some of these things well. Transportation, we're a fairly compact community. We're spending $280 per student for transportation in a school year. The average in the region is $419, considerably less. So we're only spending 3% of the school budget for transportation, while the mean is 4.2%. Debt service, we're spending a little under 10% of the school budget on debt service. The mean is now 10%, so we're right in the ballpark there. Cost per student, this is overall when you put together the whole budget. The mean is $10,100, Cape 154. Cape Elizabeth is spending $9,468, or roughly $700 less per student than the other school systems. And you look back, that's because of savings in transportation, it's because of savings in operations, it's because of savings in administration, and it is because we're spending slightly less in instruction than the mean as well, 75. But most of that, you know, 90% of that, of being less than the mean, is because we're spending less on transportation, operations, and administration. Students per classroom teacher, the mean is 13.1 students. We're at 13.5 students per classroom teacher, or slightly more students per teacher, 4/10 of a student than the mean in the area. We also have the average classroom teacher salaries. We're at 48.6 now. The mean is 48.9, which means we're $230, if my reverse math is right, below the mean. And then some say, you know, Cape Elizabeth, you know, attracts a whole lot more special ed students, and that affects the budget than other communities. Well, you look at the numbers, that's not true. 10% of the students were identified as special ed students, 181 students. That compares to the mean. Oh, that's 10%. The mean is 11.8%. So we actually have less than the average. So you know, there's a lot of other, you know, benchmarks that are out there too. You know, we could look at crime rates. We could look at educational attainment. We can look at, you know, students going on to secondary education, all the test scores, all that stuff. And I think, you know, some of those I'm sure you'll see as part of the school budget and the municipal budget as well. But basically, I think the benchmarks continue to show that the priorities in Cape Elizabeth tend to be parks and recreation, they tend to be the library, they tend to be schools, although schools, it's a little, you have to really focus. We're spending less than, you know, than the mean in other areas, but, you know, there's a lot of interesting data there to peruse. But overall, I think it shows that we're in relatively good financial shape, and it you know, does show, as Ann pointed out, that consolidation is a challenge when you're already providing reasonably good services at reasonable prices.
I would amend that to say providing excellent services. I think our schools and the municipal services are excellent and at very reasonable prices. But don't sell the schools and yourself short, please.
Again, this is on the website if anyone wants to look at the detail of any of this.
Thank you, Michael, for an outstanding report. Really appreciate it. Do we have a motion to accept the annual benchmark study?
So moved.
Second.
Okay, any discussion?
I just have a couple of questions. On the second to last page, where the top category where it says schools 2005-2006 state share, and then there's percentages. Is that's in Cape Elizabeth's case, the state paid or is going to pay 17.7% of the total costs of the school?
Yes, and they did in 2005-2006.
And my comment, my first comment is I love the graphics. Very, very creative and engaging. But I'm concerned with the school consolidation, as Ann mentioned, because the original proposal that came out of the Education Committee set the number of students at 1,200, below which would require consolidation or regionalization. And now this new subcommittee of the Appropriations Committee is circulating a proposal that sets this arbitrary threshold at 2,500 students, and it really concerns me. And I'm fortunate to sit next to Emily Kane, one of the members of the subcommittee. And so what I would like to do is kind of take the last couple of pages that have to do with the schools and use this benchmark study in my advocacy up in Augusta, with your permission.
Yeah, I can always, this is all on a single Excel spreadsheet, so I can easily, you know, only print certain sections if you'd like.
Okay, yeah, I'll take you up on that, and I'll do it at my expense. I don't know how to do that, but I'd love to get the color, because I think the graphics are great. And thank you very much for putting this together.
Ann.
And if I could add, for Cynthia's benefit, I was in a meeting with the governor a couple of weeks ago, and there was with a number of other municipal officials, and there was a lot of discussion of consolidation and regionalization. And he was promoting hard his plans, and there was a great deal of talk about the 2,500 minimum student size for a school system. And the manager of the town of Herman, Clint Deschene, was there talking about what they do in their town, and it parallels what we do in Cape Elizabeth with the one town concept. And I talked to the governor, and he seemed to be agreeing that flexibility for those towns that achieve savings through consolidating with their municipality as opposed to with other school systems, that flexibility would be key. That the focus should be on the fiscal goal, the dollar goal, the savings, as opposed to just an arbitrary number of students. And that if a school system and a town had already achieved those dollar savings, that they shouldn't be penalized for already having done the hard work that our manager and the superintendent and all their staff folks have done already. So he seemed to be willing, and some of his staff folks were there, they seemed to be willing to be thinking about that. But if it could be pushed hard in the legislature, that the focus should be on a dollar goal as opposed to just everybody has to do 10% better, and therefore we're just going to assume 2,500 students means we're going to get 10% savings, that would be very helpful for at least the interests of towns like Cape Elizabeth.
Okay. Cynthia?
I'll just respond briefly. I plan to press that point as best as I can, and I thank you for bringing it up and alerting the citizens of this town to just some of the nuances of what's happening. And I would invite and encourage everyone to write to or email or call either me, but it would be more effective if you contact members of that specific committee that include Representative Emily Kane, Senator Turner, and those are the two I've been dealing with.
Are those the Appropriations Committee folks?
Those are the Appropriations Committee people who are working on this, I believe Senator Martin, and those are the people who really need to hear, I think at this point, for, because I think a simple solution would be to just make an exception in this policy that they're creating for exemptions for communities that have already achieved certain fiscal.
If the goal could be set that the goal should be rather than 10% across the board, that it should be something like 10% under the average cost per student, something like that. I'm sure Cape Elizabeth is already there. Michael?
I just want to say, if you look at these numbers, excluding instruction, which is, you know, the governor says we're not trying to save money on instruction. Mm-hmm. We're trying to save money on these other areas. If you look at all the other areas other than instruction, we're spending about $625 less
right.
per student in the other system. You multiply that times 1,800. You come, I think that's, well, times 1,000 would be 625,000. So you're looking at about
1.1 million. It's one, yeah. 1,125,000.
Yeah, it's 1 million, thank you, Paul. It's $1,125,000 less Cape Elizabeth is spending on the non-instructional areas of its budget as a result of being below the mean for the comparable communities in our region.
Right. And if we're asked to just decrease another 10%, all the towns out there, I mean, I think many people realize there is a need within the state to consolidate and to save money for the sake of the citizens. But the folks who have already achieved some savings by having to meet just an across-the-board goal, that's going to just kill those of those towns that have already done a good job.
You know, what you point out, Ann, is so important for people to understand, and I think that people miss it when we talk about regionalization and combining various communities and school systems. And I think the point is efficiencies through collaboration. Mm-hmm. And Michael's the one that really brought that to the fore to me a couple of years ago when we were talking about the one-town concept. And I think more collaboration at the municipal and school level and more collaboration at the regional level mm-hmm. is what we need. We don't need to get rid of towns that are working. We don't need to get, you know, rid of local control. That's not the area that we're having a problem with. I think we need to encourage more cooperation. And I think we do through our participation in the Greater Portland Council of Governments, through our participation in the Maine Municipal Association, and through just what we do, excuse me?
EcoMaine.
And EcoMaine, there you go. And many other organizations that Cape Elizabeth belongs to and contributes to. And I think we have to start thinking in terms of collaboration. What can we do to collaborate? Because when you combine things, it doesn't mean you're going to get efficiencies. Regionalization does not equal more efficient processes. It just means you're combining what you already have. I think collaboration and finding cost savings, and I think we need to start looking at it more closely across borders, and we're doing that. We have the Metro Coalition, the Crime Lab, for example, that saved an enormous amount of money if you spread it over all of the six communities that are contributing to that. And I just think we need to take that to another level of interest and involvement, and we all have to start thinking that way. And we need to encourage municipalities to collaborate, and maybe that's where the governor needs to focus some of the energy to create cost savings. Anyway, any
can
other
you deliver
comments?
That message since?
Yes, I just
you get that done tomorrow.
But I think the collaboration is the key, and we have to change the way we think and talk about this. Anybody else?
If I could add yes. one other thing, it's sort of on topic. There's a bill that is working its way through the legislature, or it was as of 10 days ago. I've been away, but it's like the grandson of Tabor. Mm-hmm. It's the new Tabor bill. And if it follows the path, I forget what number it is, you probably...
Oh,
I've seen it.
I I haven't.
Well, we showed it to the governor. He was surprised, but it's, I can't even remember who's sponsoring it. I'll get the number to you, but it is, it's titled the Taxpayer Bill of Rights, and it has come back. It's a different version. It's focused mostly on the state this time, but my point is that it's going to keep coming back over and over again. So I think the legislature understands that, and the governor understands, that something needs to be done to increase efficiencies. But if it doesn't, if, you know, if things don't happen, if citizens don't perceive that things happen, meaningful things happen, then this Tabor bill is waiting in the wings, and what usually happens is it'll go through, it probably won't get through the legislature, but then they'll start collecting signatures for a citizens' referendum in 2008, so.
Well, I think that we have to recognize that people are frustrated.
Exactly.
For good reason, in many cases. So we need to be responsive and proactive and do what we can to create those efficiencies.
Right.
So anyway, back to topic here. Receipt of the annual benchmark study. We have the motions. All in favor? Thank you. Hard not to get a little excited about this stuff. All right. Item number 66-2007, approval of 2007 dog warrant. April, want to talk about that?
We've given out notices to, at the end of January, probably sent them out to a good portion. About 700 postcards were sent out at the end of January, or beginning of January, to let people know that their dog notices were late, or their licenses. They need to be renewed by the end of December, but they do have a grace period of the whole month of January to get that in. If your dog is spayed or neutered, it's $6. If your dog is not, it's $10 fee. After February 1st and then on, you have a $15 late fee on top of your dog license fee, and then after tonight there will be a $25 late fee. Within the last month, we contacted about 150 dog owners, and about 100 of them have come in, so the list is down to about 48 people.
Okay.
So.
Excellent. Thank you. Jim? Well, actually, let's get a motion.
I would move approval of the 2007 dog warrant.
Second.
Thank you. Jim, go ahead.
I was just pleased not to see my dog's mugshot on here, and I would second the motion.
I was pleased also that I paid up.
All right. The motion is moved and seconded. Any further discussion? Okay. All in favor? Next is item number 67-2007, approval of lease renewal for town hall space for the Cape Courier of Cape Elizabeth. Michael.
The Cape Courier has been a tenant of the town for, I don't know exactly, 10, 12 years. Anyway, they pay a nominal amount. They have a space that's right below the William Jordan Conference Room, sort of on a half level. It's space we would not otherwise be using. It's not handicap accessible. It's very limited, and they pay us $1,200 a year for that space. And I'm suggesting that we renew the lease for an additional three-year period, for a term of 36 months.
As opposed to a turn.
Okay, do we have a motion?
So moved.
Second? Anybody?
Second.
Thank you. Any discussion?
I should mention that they're a not-for-profit as well. They're not a profit, for-profit newspaper.
They're volunteers, pretty much. Yeah. Okay. Okay, all in favor? There we go. Okay, now we are to citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. Seeing no hands go up?
No citizens.
We'll move on to adjournment. Do I have a motion? For adjournment?
Move to adjourn.
Second. All in favor? All right. Thank you.